As you probably know, there are some interesting whistled languages out there, the most popular one probably being Silbo-Gomero, which is based on Spanish. Now, you may be wondering what that has to do with the language of the Ents. Well, try to imagine how would you write a sentence in a whistled language. What would be the syntax? Well, assuming it is even possible, it would probably consist of many inflection marks, lines, accent signs, etc. Ultimately though, it's like trying to fit a square into a circle. It wasn't meant for that. And that brings me to Entish. Okay, now imagine combining a whistled language with Chinese and the oldest version of English we know of. So old that half of it is still unknown till today. And you get to the difficulty of Entish. If you've watched the Lord of the Rings movies, you probably remember the scene of the Hobbits talking to the Ents, asking them for help. One thing that this scene implied was the sheer length of the Entish speech, like of singular words. One of the biggest reasons behind that is the fact that the Ents don't want to say anything that isn't worth saying. Basically, we don't know a lot about Entish. Quite frankly, we barely know anything. We know the overall rules and its backstory, but the entire Entish dictionary would probably fit inside a single tweet. Yeah, at least when it comes to the words we know of. So, is there any point in exploring it? Can we learn it? And what does it tell us about the world of Middle-earth and Mr. Tolkien's linguistic fascinations? Firstly, you have to know that there are two variations of Entish, the old and the new, of course. But okay, this is so interesting actually. So in the old days, Ents didn't have a language, but as I'm sure you know, the elves had one. Well, actually, they had a couple of them. They always were kind of like the aristocracy of Middle-earth, right? Well-dressed, threw feasts, and enjoyed the finer things in life. Nothing wrong with that, of course, but it's definitely unlike the Ents. So when the two races met in the First Age, those eerie ones, get it, basically taught the Ents how to freaking speak. That must have been a grueling process. So now, you may be thinking that Old Entish was influenced by Sindarin or Quenya or some form of primitive Elvish. Well, not so fast. The Old Entish is kind of like the original Entish, as it was created entirely by this race, from scratch. It was a tonal language, so the meaning of a syllable depended on the specific tone applied to it. That's why I said it was partly like Chinese. Although in Mandarin, there are only four tones and one neutral one. Whereas in Old Entish, I mean, we don't really know, it could have been dozens or hundreds. I also said that it was kind of like a whistled language. That's because its sound has been described as similar to a woodwind instrument. Makes sense, eh? And it may also be similar in difficulty to Old English, as it is quite an early version of a language we know today. Combine those three and you truly get Old Entish. I mean, safe to say, not only you cannot learn it, because we basically don't have any written records of it, but even if they existed, a human still wouldn't be able to pronounce such complex sounds. Not to mention the sheer length and nuance that comes with the nature of the Ents and their tonal language. I mean, just answering a yes or no question would probably result in an hour-long monologue regarding the particular decision. Fortunately though, we have a single example of true, genuine, Chad Old Entish, but more on that in a moment. For now, we have to go through New Entish, but now, there's a light at the end of the tunnel. So, New Entish was a bit more carefully crafted, although also by the Ents, of course. However, they borrowed some words from Quenya and tried to fit them within the already established structure of Entish. So basically, they tried creating a mishmash of the two in order to communicate a bit more easily and hopefully more quickly. However, it's still super difficult to learn. Actually, we have no record of anybody learning Entish. Anybody who isn't an Ent, of course. Its pronunciation, if we can call it that, was too difficult even for elves. I mean, just imagine being a tree sitting in the ground for centuries and all of a sudden somebody teaches you to speak. I know, we've all been there, right? But, you know, Entish is literally the language of the trees. We have to take this step back and basically admire Mr. Tolkien's genius again regarding this phenomenal world building. Talking trees and their language makes sense in this universe, even if that means that we, humans, can't really learn it. But it doesn't mean we can't appreciate it. Like, you know what's cool? Each word, especially each adjective, tells a story of the thing it describes. Like, can you imagine, instead of having a name, each time you introduce yourself, having to recall your whole life, in some set level of detail, of course. One of the Ents, Treebeard, actually introduced this idea in the books. He said, quote, "So my name is like a story. Real names tell you the story of the things they belong to in my language, in the old Entish, as you might say. And goddamn, trees can live for a long time." This also comes into play when Treebeard was describing orcs. He tried to translate the original meaning directly into common speech, so basically our English, and what came out of it was a couple of adjectives. Basically, it goes like this. Orcs are evil-eyed, black-handed, bow-legged, flint-hearted, claw-fingered, foul-bellied, bloodthirsty. So, if you wanted to say orcs in Entish, you'd have to say the Entish equivalent of all those words, or even more, and each adjective takes so freaking long to say. Treebeard realized that even the common speech translation is too long and impractical for other races. That's because the orc's name is as long as years of torment. Words have meaning, I guess. Words tell a story, and the Ents took that literally. We can even apply this principle to other languages, like Treebeard did with Quenya in the books, describing an object with a series of adjectives, or a person with a list of qualities. Not in everyday scenarios, of course, but as a thought experiment. But that brings me back to the only example of true Entish that we have. It goes like this. Try guessing what this word means. Well, it means hill. Yeah, a hill. Now, I don't know if there's even any point in trying to pronounce it. Even Mr. Tolkien said that this example is probably very inaccurate. If you think about it, there's no indication of tones, no pronunciation guide. I mean, the Ents probably had limited vocal ability, right? Due to the fact that their bodily tissue was just wood. So, I'm not going to try this. I don't want to butcher this singular example of Entish. If you want to hear it for yourself, just record yourself saying it, change the pitch, slow it down by 1000%, add some autotune, and you'll be a percent of the way there. No, really, I don't recommend it. Let's just leave it be. And finally, that brings us to Treebeard's description of Entish. He said that it is a lovely language, but it takes a very long time to say anything in it. Because we do not say anything in it unless it is worth taking a long time to say and to listen to. And I think we can apply a bit of that to our everyday lives. Maybe that's the way to go. Either way, I want to thank you so much for being here and watching this video. This video about the poetic, lyrical, ancient, peculiar, mysterious, mostly unknown, fanciful, extravagant, wondrous, lingering language. Oh, I mean Entish. And seeing.